often referred to as America's classical music, jazz is punctuated by a series of key figures who provoked a reevaluation of the genre's perceived limitations. Duke Ellington, Dizzy Gillespie, Charlie Parker, Billie Holiday, Chet Baker, Ella Fitzgerald, and John Coltrane would all leave an indelible mark on the history of a music famed for its chameleon-like mutability. And so, too, with Miles Davis, a trumpeter, composer, and bandleader whose career struck a precarious balance between innovation and controversy, celebration and vilification. Davis made some of the most revered recordings in jazz history, including Kind of Blue, Sketches of Spain, and Bitches Brew. In many ways, his music embodies the multi-directional, conflicted, and perennially changing ethos of 20th century jazz. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and on this episode of Classic Album Sundays Worldwide, I'll be exploring, in a silent way, one of Miles Davis's many musical turning points and a transitional moment in the development of jazz as a whole. Silent Way is considered by many to be the first fusion recording. It commenced Miles's most divisive phase, his electric period. This groundbreaking album would test latent tensions surrounding the future identity of jazz, its relationship with new technology, and the question of authenticity. And there was hardly a figure more primed to stoke this fire than the perpetually provocative Davis. The young instrumentalist received his first trumpet at the age of 9, at which point he was already a keen listener of gospel, blues, and big band music. Taking up lessons with one of his father's dental patients, Davis was rather forcefully nudged away from playing in the then fashionable vibrato style and encouraged instead to explore a vibrant, clear mid-range tone, a sound he would later describe as having no attitude in it. His career began after he moved from his hometown of Alton, Illinois to New York City, where he studied at the famed arts institution Juilliard. His time there was cut short, partly by his own growing disillusionment, but also because of his eagerness to explore the city's nocturnal jazz hotspots in search of his idol, the famed soloist Charlie Parker. It wasn't long before Davis had worked his way into the musician's inner circle, replacing Dizzy Gillespie and Parker's quintet by 1945.
Thank you.
1945, that's Billy's Bounce by Charlie Parker, featuring a young Miles Davis, Dizzy Gillespie on piano, Curly Russell on bass, and Max Roach on drums on classic album Sundays Worldwide. Around the time of this recording, Davis toured the country with big names such as Benny Carter and Charles Mingus, visiting spots such as St. Louis and Los Angeles, and taking part in numerous studio sessions along the way. He was fully dedicated to music, specifically bebop, but aided by alcohol and cocaine, much to the detriment of his girlfriend and young daughter. The following two decades saw Davis's star rise exponentially as he moved through several distinct phases. In the late 40s and early 50s, he became part of a wave of young musicians increasingly dissatisfied with the prioritization of virtuosity and bebop. Guided by arranger Gil Evans, they triggered a backlash that became known as cool jazz, melodious, laid-back compositions, which sought to emulate the serene pleasures of the human voice. This sound is encapsulated on his 1957 classic, Birth of the Cool. From the LP Birth of the Cool, that's Miles Davis with Giroux. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and you're tuned into Classic Album Sundays Worldwide. And on this edition, I'm taking a close look at our album of the month, Miles Davis's 1969 LP, In a Silent Way. But let's rewind a bit. The 1950s were a turbulent time for Davis, whose heroin addiction was supported by intermittent musical activity and the unsavory exploitation of friends and prostitutes. After detoxing in Detroit, where drug access was more limited, Davis returned to New York by the middle of the decade to record albums for labels such as Blue Note and Prestige. He swerved into new stylistic lanes, such as the hard bop sound birthed on 1957's Walkin', and explorations of modal jazz alongside the likes of Bill Evans. This period would lead to some of his most widely celebrated albums. 1957's Miles Ahead marked Davis's first foray into the classical tradition, aided by arranger Gil Evans, who combined the songs into a suite. In 1959, Miles Davis released two critically acclaimed albums, Porgy and Bess and his immortal classic, Kind of Blue, featuring his sextet of John Coltrane, Cannonball Adderley, Bill Evans or Wynton Kelly on piano rotation, Paul Chambers on bass, and drummer Jimmy Cobb. This album would have influence far beyond the borders of jazz and remains the biggest selling jazz LP to this day.
Thank you.
And Miles hadn't come near to exhausting his seemingly endless source of inspiration, as less than a year after the release of Kind of Blue, he unleashed another weighty and transformative work, Sketches of Spain. This album saw him reinterpret works by Spanish folk composers, fusing the original music with improvisation, world music, and European classical tradition. Will-O-The-Wisp from one of my own favorite Miles Davis albums, Sketches of Spain. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, leading up to our album of the month, In a Silent Way, on Classic Albums Sundays Worldwide. In the early 60s, Davis's mindset was one of symbiosis and expansion. Describing his attitude at the time, he stated, "The thing I have to do now is make things connect, make them mean something in what I play around it." By the late 60s, Davis's notoriety as a difficult and occasionally abusive collaborator had seen him attract and repel musicians in equal measure. And despite losing key figures such as Sonny Rollins in the early half of the decade, Davis commenced a working relationship with some promising up-and-coming talents. Amongst them were the 17-year-old drummer Tony Williams and the Chicago-raised pianist Herbie Hancock.
Thank you.
Watermelon Man from Taken Off, the debut album by pianist Herbie Hancock and the record that put him on Miles Davis's radar. The addition of young musicians Tony Williams and Hancock reinvigorated Miles Davis's musical passion during a period of prolonged ill health, which had resulted in canceled tour dates and extended hospital stays for surgical procedures. By 1966, his sales figures had dipped to around 40,000 per album, a sharp fall from the typical 100,000 he was achieving just a few years prior. While Davis was no longer the young, hip savant he once was, there was another force that would renew his interest in contemporary pop, his relationship with a youthful singer, Betty Mabry, later to become Betty Davis. Title track from Davis collaborator Chick Corea's debut album, Tones for Joan's Bones, on Classic Album Sundays Worldwide. Also added to the lineup for the recording of our album of the month, In a Silent Way, were Austrian keyboardist Joseph Zawinul and British guitarist John McLaughlin. They were also asked to participate after just a few weeks in the States since joining the Tony Williams Lifetime Band. Thank you. Davis and his supporting cast of seven musicians gathered at New York City's CBS 30th Street studio on February 18, 1969, and in a mere 3 hours recorded the entire album that would become In a Silent Way. As Hancock recalled, he knew that it was about risk-taking and encouraging the musician to capture the moment, how you're feeling in that moment, and having the daring and conviction to go for it, even if you don't make it. Was now using electric keyboards such as the Fender Rhodes in the studio to compose and record, and this shifted the group's approach to the music. Hancock remembers that Miles began stacking several keyboards on a track. We might have two or three keyboards going, and we'd all try to go somewhere, playing some ornaments that would add a different element to everything else that was going on. Davis encouraged unconventionality from his players, reportedly telling McLaughlin to play as if he had never used a guitar before. But he was also keen to emphasize the panoramic scope and languorous pace he desired. He willed his musicians to play in a considered, minimal, yet unrestrained style, often suggesting how melodies should be played and for how long. Davis's increasingly fragmented approach to composition was applied to both his own ideas and those of his collaborators. Thank you. album's A-side, Shh, Peaceful, use a sonata form Davis had explored in previous work to create an understated sense of tension and relief, giving the piece its distinctive cyclical character and binding its contrasting segments together. Producer Teo Macero, with whom Davis had worked on Kind of Blue, Porgy and Bess, and Sketches of Spain, was a hugely influential presence. His studio editing expertise welded together the multiple recording takes that would make up each side of the album. Macero's mixing innovations heightened the role of the producer in jazz composition. His relationship with Davis was like that between George Martin and the Beatles.
Thank you.
Half of In a Silent Way begins and ends with a composition previously created by Joseph Zawinul, titled by his collaborator, Cannonball Adderley, whilst the pair were in the same band. The title track dwells in an introspective atmosphere, commencing and then concluding in a misty haze of sustained chords and plaintively melodic trumpet.
Thank you.
For the recording of In a Silent Way, Miles Davis endeavored to follow a rock-oriented approach in his reinterpretation of the original Zawinul composition, stripping out chords that he felt were unnecessary or disruptive to the song's cool, liquid flow. This created a notable air of tension between the pair, Zawinul feeling somewhat supplanted and undercredited for his role in the creative process, and Davis maintaining his belief that the album would have been far less successful with its original incarnation. The 1969 release of In a Silent Way marked the beginning of a whole new era, not only in jazz, but the wider popular music industry. Synthesizing an array of creative techniques and forward-facing musical ideas from rock, jazz, orchestral, and electronic music, it created a blueprint that Miles Davis would detail further on his outstanding follow-up, Bitches Brew. described as proto-ambient, In a Silent Way also reimagined the listener's relationship with music, predicting how future generations would utilize sound to establish subtle oral atmospheres years ahead of the likes of Brian Eno and Harold Budd. But the album had a fair share of resistance. Tayo Macero's process of editing several recordings into one composition was met with particular scorn, dismissed as antithetical to the spontaneous ideals of jazz. Rock critics were pleased by Davis's psychedelic approach, whilst the jazz critics felt a sense of betrayal as Davis moved beyond the established boundaries of a genre that was suffering a decline in mainstream popularity. In a Silent Way was not just an album, but an existential crisis. Its stubborn resistance to established stylistic labels provoked both paranoia and excitement about the future. It foreshadowed a decade which would bring yet more innovation and tribalism within popular music. But listen close enough and you'll hear the album's influence within a plethora of styles, from avant-garde electronic dance music to chart-climbing pop, ushering in our new fascination with technology and its invaluable creative contribution. Miles Davis's Quiet Storm continues to rumble on. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and thanks for listening to Classic Album Sundays Worldwide.